This audio is from the Axis Church in Nashville, Tennessee, and is part of the Advent Sermon Series. For more information, please visit theaxischurch.org.
Thank you all so much. I'm going to read the Christmas story as a part of our Christmas Eve gathering today, and I encourage you to try to listen with fresh hearing. Try to hear this as much as we possibly can, as if this is the first time you heard such news. From Luke chapter 1. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." She was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to think through and discern what sort of greeting that might be. Because in this time, during these times, there was this fear and belief that if you did see an angel, there was an angel of death escorting you into eternity. So she was trying to filter through and discern, what is this? Like, what's about to happen with my life? Little did she know. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How will this be since I'm a virgin?" The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son and is in the sixth month with her who was previously called barren, for nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold," such a wonderful response, "I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. In chapter 2 of Luke, in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinus was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. So Joseph went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. He went there to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a trough like a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, and they were keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they too, much like Mary, were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior." This is more than a friend, more than a good guy. A Savior who is Christ the Lord. Now this will be a sign for you. You're going to find the baby wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a trough, a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of other heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." Then when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste, and they found Mary, they found Joseph, they found this baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told him. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had seen, heard and seen, as it had been told them. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given him by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. That's the Christmas story. What does Christmas mean to you? I know this time of year we're our attention is captivated. That's right. Yeah. With parades, with NBA and NFL activity on TV, with big meals, with sweet treats, with getting presents. It's pretty awesome. Giving presents. We're trying to make that feel awesome. Even at 44, I like getting more than I like giving, but I'm working on it. But there's lights, there's trees, there's music, there's family time, there's boundaries. With family time, that's this time of year. But is there deep significance with Christmas beyond these sorts of things, beyond the traditions? What's the why for you behind Christmas? What do you think of when you think of Christmas? What's it mean to you? I love it. Keep it coming. What do you feel? This is Christmas. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would have eternal life, live forever. For God did not send his son into the world 2,000 years ago to condemn and shame the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. And whoever believes in Jesus Christ is not condemned. Today, tomorrow, forever, not condemned. Whoever believes in him. That's Christmas. When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons and daughters, God has sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. And we know that 2,000 years ago, roughly, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. For we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and full of truth. There's never been a more dynamic and complex person than Jesus Christ. Fully grace, at the same time, fully truth. We have to pick and choose. We compartmentalize. He was wide open, full of grace, wide open, full of truth. Christ redeemed us, according to Galatians and Paul there, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it's written, cursed is everyone who's hanged on a tree. This was his mission. His mission wasn't just to be worshiped and adored as a child at Christmas, but one to love and serve and be loved by because he was hung upon a tree in the place of us. For in him all the fullness of God is pleased to dwell, and through Christ to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you who were once alienated from God, hostile towards God, in your mind you were doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death. He's reconciled you back to himself in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before God Almighty. This is the good news. This presenting you to his Father, presenting you holy and blameless before God, this is what the original Christmas was all about. Jesus came to earth to glorify his Father and to save you. That's why Christmas, because you had to be saved. You had to be rescued. God was not going to allow you just to simply drift into a godless eternity, though this is what we deserved and what we asked for through our rebellion. He interrupts our rebellion. He interrupts our eternal death. He interrupts our eternal funeral in order to step into human time and space 2,000 years ago to save you from yourself, to save you from your sins, to save you from your past, to save you from your fears, and to give you hope and contentment, joy and happiness now and forever. That's why there's Christmas. God sent his son Jesus to earth to forgive you of your sins, to clean your heart, to clean your mind, to make you fit for heaven. Fit for heaven means holy and blameless and above reproach before God. It's not just improving a little. It's becoming entirely new and different. You see, Christ's ultimate goal was not earth or even your heart, but for you to be with him in heaven forever. And my encouragement is that you will participate in Christmas with a whole heart, with a full heart this year, thinking about what Christmas really means. Because to participate in Christmas activities without worshiping Jesus from your heart, you miss out on so much of what Christmas is. You miss out on everything, really. But to participate with Christmas as you worship Jesus Christ from your heart, much like Mary, treasuring these things up in your heart, man, you've got life, you've got hope, you've got contentment, you've got peace, you've got happiness. And so remember Christ Jesus. Remember his saving mission tonight, tomorrow, and every other day of your life. Remember. And consider these things. Press more and more into these things today and tomorrow and throughout the coming year. And ask God if he can teach you and guide you how to celebrate him with your whole heart, with your whole life. And I'll close with Titus chapter 3. But when the goodness and loving kindness of our God, our Savior, appeared, he saved us, not because of our own works done by righteousness or by our sins, our works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that being justified by grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is the good news. This is the heart of Christmas. As a part of our gathering today, we're offering communion to those who acknowledge Jesus as Savior and Lord. You see, Jesus was born to die. The night before Jesus died, he gathered his 12 disciples in the upper room, and he was telling them specifically of his time to die, that it was imminent. He took some bread and he took some wine, shared them with them as a way of remembering him and his life and his death. He said that the bread was symbolic of the life that he lived, perfectly in the flesh, that was broken for them. And he says that the wine is symbolic of the blood that would come from his body leading to his death as he shed his son so that their sins could be forgiven. And so on this Christmas Eve, those who are Christians, we're going to come take this bread and remember the perfect life of Jesus Christ, broken for us. We're going to dip it into the juice or wine, symbolic of the death of Christ and the blood that he shed from his body as he was hanging as a curse for us. This is how we are saved, through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I want you to think through these things. Such a powerful picture, such powerful elements that illustrate the life and death of Christ. We're going to have servers on either side of the stage and self-serve stations in the back two corners. Friend, please think about what you're doing here. Think about this communion as you come and take. Let's pray. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And we proclaim the great mystery of the Christian faith, that Christ indeed has come. He's lived perfectly. He's died as our substitute. He's risen in victory, and he will surely come again to rule and reign over all things forever and ever. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be on this time of communion, this time of worshiping and remembering. And remain with us always, even through the end of the age. Amen. Well, Christian, when you're ready, please come and take, remembering the finished work of Jesus Christ. You can come when you're ready.